time for the final talk, actually the keynote speak. I'm very excited about it. As a guest this year, we have Pieter Hintjens. We've invited him in. Pieter is a very well-known and very well-respected member of the open source community. He's been building all kinds of software from distributed systems and or whatever. ZeroMQ, one of these things he's been working on. And well, there's tons of things I could mention. He's been quite vocal about patents, how you call them, as well. He's an excellent writer. His blog is actually one of the things that you should read, I think, as a developer. But also, if you're interested in the bigger picture, read his blog. He's an excellent writer when it comes to psychopaths as well. More about it later. Always good for a lively conversation. I'd like to give the floor to Pieter. I think one tip. Mingle yourself in a discussion, raise your hand, start conversations. I think that's the important part of today as well. Keep it alive. Don't sit back and listen, but raise your hand and ask the questions. I think that's the thing. Pieter, thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Big round of applause for me. Come on. Bring it up. Okay. So we won't do slides. We'll just do it like this. And when you have questions, which I hope you will have questions, just please type them. And if I don't pay attention to the questions, raise your hand and point to this. Oh, goodness gracious. It's the first time I try this, so. Oh. Okay, I want a volunteer to come up here and press the down arrow, because I will lose concentration. Volunteer, somebody? Scroller. Okay. Feel free to come and scroll down. So what I will talk about mostly are my experiences in about 30 years of building distributed systems. It's very close to what you discussed earlier, and I will take on some of the points from this morning's panel discussion. Most of you weren't there, and you should have been there. It was very good. It's scrolling by itself.
No, it's not.
No. Okay.
We have a scroller.
I guess most of what we do fails in this industry, which is interesting because experiments should fail, but they should be small and not too painful. I mean, big experiments fail are kind of traumatic and wasteful. So I'm going to talk about the biggest problems that we've had in trying to make distributed systems. When they've failed and when they succeed is not really interesting, but when they fail, it's really sometimes amazing. And I will try to give you some indications of how to kind of like avoid painful, embarrassing, big failures. Or at least when you see them happening, move away and watch them from a distance and, you know, laugh when it happens. They can be very predictable sometimes. So distributed systems are about essentially, in my mind, essentially about making our software look more and more like the real world. The real world is distributed. Light has latency. Sound has latency. This concept of things happening in the same time and same space is a lie. It's only in kind of maths that you have a pure numbers, and only in this kind of insane maths of software that we have things like pure state and even presence and existence. So the software, as it tries to grow into the real world, discovers the real world doesn't care about reliability, isn't there when you expect it, it isn't even there at all sometimes, it comes much later. It's very strange, the real world. So the biggest difficulty we have is as engineers and architects to map our kind of mathematical, are there questions? No. Mathematical way of thinking onto this real world, which doesn't give a fuck about mathematics. It really doesn't. I mean, of course it's using it, but doesn't care about it. You have to press buttons as well.
Oh, no, I'm gonna fix it.
Wow, that's awesome. Okay. Rule number one of building software, bring in your community. Don't try and do it yourself. Be incompetent and bring people in on board to fix your incompetence. So why is this real world thing such a big issue? Why are we moving into the Internet of Things? And what's the underlying trend here? Well, it's one of scale and cost and scale. I call this cost gravity. Things get cheaper and cheaper and cheaper, so we make more and more of them. We use more and more of them. The number of computers that we have in our pockets, in our bags, just keeps doubling every couple of years. That will never stop. If you think that you've understood the scale, this is beautiful though, then you haven't. It's going to keep doubling, and our brains can't handle that very well. So the numbers of computers you have to talk to keeps growing. You talk about owning a computer. How do you own a billion computers? How do you upgrade a billion computers? You can't. The concept is meaningless. So these things that we're building, these smart things we're building, get less and less connected to our central control, our manic obsession with things. And there's the difficulty. Talking to stuff which is very far away, which comes and which may not look like anything we expect, which someone else runs, which may break at any point in time. Okay. So the first problem that we had was that our technology did not work for this. Oh, yeah. Okay. That's good. I mean, we have this vision of things talking to things. This is an old vision. It's 1960s, 1950s. And yet to make it work is incredibly expensive. Who's built a stack on TCP? Who here's built a stack using TCP? Anyone? Okay, who's built a server stack using TCP? Ah, you see, okay. Who's built a production quality server stack that can handle thousands of connections at once? Right, nobody. And yet, to program a thing on the internet, even a modest thing, has to be able to speak to thousands of other things. You need these stacks, and these stacks are very hard to make. This is one reason why the internet went all webby, because we found one stack that worked. Oh my God, HTTP. Let's use this everywhere. I can download the client, the server, I can make it work more or less, and we're still using HTTP. This crappy thing is HTTP. It's offensive. It doesn't even work, does it? Did you get it working again?
Well, I got mine, but it doesn't even work.
Mosh? Okay. Stand corrected.
Oh, yeah.
What does a stack mean? So a stack is the software which can talk to other pieces. And the problem there immediately is that talking to is quite complex, and other pieces means all kinds of weird things. So like in a server, a web server, each piece you talk to is a browser. It's a remote browser. There's a connection. There's state in the connection. There's parsing the commands. There's sending replies. It's handling errors. The browser goes away. The browser comes back. The browser makes more and more requests. And these requests have to be handled independently. How do you do that? Oh, you make one process per browser. It's fantastic. I have now a box with 2,000 processes. My box is now dead. Okay, make one thread per browser. Okay, I make now 2,000 threads. My box again is dead. These are old boxes. Huh? So just trying to handle these connections in parallel or even apparent parallel is very difficult. And it takes a lot of time to do this properly. Expertise, money, teams, infrastructure, boxes. And so you get to this concentration of power. We get to the web in 1999. It's a big thing. And I remember when I was, this is 1995, my first open source projects of any success were open source web servers, one called Shitami, which is Ematic spelled backwards, which ran on Windows, which could do amazing things because it was just written very well. So we began then making it cheaper to run stuff on boxes. Still, writing a web server is very, very hard. The protocols are not well designed. I mean, they work, but they are very expensive to parse. They have lots and lots of holes, which is why we see all this work on new versions of HTTP, WebSockets, and so on. Cool. I like it. Thank you. So that's number one. Technology must be addressing the problem of cost of making these communication stacks. One of my favorite projects is ZeroMQ, not because it's particularly fantastic, but because it brings the costs of doing this stuff way down, way down. If you're connecting pieces and you're not using something like ZeroMQ, or actually ZeroMQ, then you're probably doing it wrong, in my opinion. There's lots of other alternatives. They're all bad implementations of ZeroMQ. Now, ZeroMQ is good for several surprising reasons. Not because the core technology is really fantastic. It's not. It's just ordinary. It does its job pretty well. But it's most attractive feature, the most useful feature, is the community. Lesson number two is that the next biggest thing that we lack in this space is knowledge. And the ability to teach each other models and to propagate models and knowledge, it's still very difficult to build distributed systems, and the people that can do it well are very few, and they don't talk about it much, and when they do, we don't really listen. So building culture, we have a question. Thank you, moderator. You can use it for that, but that's like trying to, you know, my goodness, that's like using electricity to make fire and flames. I mean, you can do it, but it's kind of retrograde. Sure. ZeroMQ is a lot of things. It's an API that talks to asynchronous communication engines, and one of those is a raw socket that can talk to any TCP socket, including HTTP. And I have an example on my blog of a 10-line web server. It's not a real web server, but it does actually talk HTTP. And it does it surprisingly well. Okay, so that's number two, is building culture, building knowledge. These problems are solvable, but they're difficult to solve, and they take a lot of work, a lot of sharing of knowledge and experience, and that requires culture. So ZeroMQ is one of the first really successful big open source communities built around distributed systems. One of the first. There have been many technologies which have failed because they were proprietary, they were this, they were that, but mostly because they were small communities. Mostly because they were small communities, specialized communities, people who are very clever, who work together, who like other clever people, and who are very exclusive, and therefore it dies. You see, being smart isn't enough. You've got to be popular. No, more than that, you have to actually spread the knowledge wide. So ZeroMQ did that very effectively. We have hundreds of language bindings. There are tens of thousands of projects using it, mostly silently, because mostly it just works. And no one really cares. No one really makes a big fuss about it. It's like, I'm using C99. Like, yes. No, but it works. Like, well, of course it does. Why would you even write about it? Okay. Now, those are the first two things. So the cost of making stacks and the access to knowledge. The third thing, which is surprising, and people have taken a while to understand that, it's Conway's Law. Who's heard of Conway's Law? It's a trending subject for a theory. Conway's Law says that an organization will build software that looks the way the organization talks. In other words, if you are a centralized, hierarchical, power-crazy organization, you will build centralized, hierarchical, power-crazy software. Not just naturally, but almost by definition. In other words, to build distributed systems, you must be a distributed organization. This is very, very difficult now. Now we're heading into territory of politics and money and billions of dollars of people who want to own. And yes, but you can't build a big system, scalable, billions of pieces, if you are a conventional company or a conventional team. How many of you go to meetings and have meetings regularly for work? Okay, who does not have meetings for work as a matter of strategy? One, two, okay, you're the winners. I'm sorry to say it. But if you are having meetings, you are doing mutual exclusive deadlocks. You are having blocking shared state in your organization, which slows you all down and makes you all single processors, even though maybe hundreds of you. Meetings are cyclical barriers for organizations. They force you to all stop what you're doing, to all stop thinking, agree on some common state, and then carry on. It's the most offensive, wasteful, stupid, I have no words to describe it. But it's a sign of something bad in your organization. It's a sign that your organization cannot operate without forcing all its components to think about the same things at the same time, which is not how you build distributed systems.
There was one question about how...
I cannot repeat those questions.
There was one question I saw spinning by that says, how about daily stand-ups?
So daily stand-ups for me is the same. I mean, the very notion that you can even identify who is in your team for me is a counter pattern. The concept of a stand-up, the concept of a team, the concept of identifying who to talk to at any one time is a counter, is an anti-pattern. Right? And this isn't just me being philosophical. This is the result of a long process of removing problems in the ZeroMQ community. Now, we started that community with a very small team of experts and a very focused, vision-driven approach to making stuff, which was catastrophically bad. If you used ZeroMQ2, and then you watched as we made ZeroMQ3 and ZeroMQ4, you know how bad it was. We had three versions out there, all incompatible with each other. But that's why we have major versions, right? No, that's fine. That's what you call contract breakage. If you break contracts, you're an asshole. The people are using. If you're breaking contracts no one is using, that's fine. That's called experimentation. So we moved over years from a process driven by meetings and discussion and vision. No, this is sharing beer. This is not the same thing. We're not planning any software. We're not trying to synchronize in any state at all. We're just exchanging ideas. This is a very, very good pattern. This is fantastic. And so meeting people, that's fantastic. Exchanging ideas and exchanging problems is fantastic. This is a market. However, if we were trying to agree now on what editor to use or what language to use, so there'll be no food this evening until we've agreed on a language, we will all starve. We will literally prefer to starve than give up our favorite language. Well, that's what meetings do. They force the organization into compromises that are neither necessary nor healthy. Okay. So we had this with ZeroMQ. We had these meetings, these meetups, which were, you know, you would do this as in the community. You'd organize the meetups. We had 2 days, 3 days of planning and argument and decisions, completely for nothing. Completely for nothing. And we moved into a very different model of organization, which I've written about in my book a lot, my books, two books, three books, I don't know. Basically, we try to be a large problem-solving machine that discovers problems as they emerge from use and solves them organically and asynchronously with minimum communication, minimum friction, only exchanging solutions and problems, and then brutally negotiating to get the best price from our suppliers, which means us, ourselves. So basically building an economy out of pieces and people and possibilities and knowledge. And over time, things get cheaper and cheaper, but then we specialize in new areas where we can make more profit individually. So my community, I don't even know who they are. I don't know where they come from. I don't have to trust them. I don't have to pay them. That's the best part. I don't own what they make either, though. I have no claim on their work. All I can do is ask them to, you know, come to this party that we've built and join in the party. And this group of people, very spread out and very, very diverse and very loosely coupled, matches the software we're making. And that matches the real world of things in the future. So distributed systems emerge from distributed organizations, which emerge from certain ways of working. And those ways of working are, now the next thing, contracts and regulations. So you can't do anarchism. It does not work. You cannot say, let's just contribute code. Hey, it's fantastic. Does not work, right? That does not work. That does not work. I mean, you try that, and it's great, and then one person turns up who's got a devious character, and your whole system falls apart. And those people are there in this room. There's two or three of us who are particularly devious, more than me even. And yes. And you need rules, and you need regulation, and you need authority. And so distributed systems, like distributed organizations, have to have contracts, have to have the authority that enforces contracts, that punishes bad actors. There's got to be a ability to participate and the ability to reject participants, at the very minimum. I'm sure there's more to it than that, but it's like being in a market. You can come and open a shop that sells food. That's pretty much anyone can do that if you have a certain level of documentation. But if you produce poisonous food and you kill your customers, you will be banned from ever again making food, probably by physical restraint. IRC is anarchy. A bad actor could miss. No, because, you see, I'm choosing to read the questions or not. There's no... Doesn't disturb me in the slightest. Has anyone here actually made a pull request to one of my projects, ever? Never. Oh my goodness.
No.
Is anyone here a programmer? We are a few programmers. Okay. And the rest are what, marketing students? Or what do you people do? I mean, if you're not making pull requests, what are you doing? What's wrong with you people? So my projects are fun because people send pull requests and they're kind of timid, and then they expect to be, you know, the first time, they expect to be slightly challenged. And I just merged the pull request right away. I was like, I merge it. They're like, why, you merged it? I'm like, of course I merged it. Welcome to the party. And they're like, wow, did you review my code? I'm like, no. Did you run some tests? I'm like, why would I run tests on your code? I mean, either your code is great or it's not great. Either way, I'm not going to test it. That's not my problem. I mean, it may be, kind of incidentally, I may later on go and look and say, what did he do? Oh my God, that was my favorite piece of source code. What did you do? You put in tabs. We don't use tabs. We use spaces. Damn! And I will fix it, make a pull request, and someone else will merge it. It works surprisingly well if you do it the right way. It works surprisingly well. And it teaches us that in a distributed system, what you really want is participation. That's to say, what kills systems is not that they're slow or unreliable or inefficient. It's that nobody cares. That's all. We have this great party. Nobody came. Now, I have a building in Brussels, which I bought a long time ago, which has this huge space, and we have some great parties. And sometimes you give these great parties, and no one comes. And it's just like, okay, that was a waste of time. That's the worst. People come to the party, it's always good. with some exceptions. We had the police a few times. No more house music. It's finished. Yes. And so that's your goal as architect of a distributed system, is to make something people can participate in. You're trying to build a party, a fun thing. The people will come in and very cheaply and very easily come in and participate and make money from it. Economics, it has to be profitable. People go to parties for particular reasons. They want free booze, they want to meet people of the opposite sex or the same sex, and they want to dance and shake off some energy and possibly not get photographed, whatever it is. But they have motives. Those motives are not, I want to take part in an experimental space. No, come on. Let's be human about it. The same with doing software. We do it for money, for profit, opportunity, learning, something. There's got to be a reason for it. So building a system of pieces that you don't control, that you haven't invented yourself, with people you don't pay, you don't know where they come from, you can't even trust, right? It's got to be economically interesting. That means there's got to be profit quickly, some kind of profit. Learning, using, getting profit from using stuff is the best. This makes sense so far? You're all very quiet. How many of you at university? Okay. So all I'm saying is bullshit, right? Don't trust me for a second. Anyone talking confidently is full of rubbish. You have to criticize what I'm saying. Take it as a hypothesis, not as you know, as a fact. It's just opinion. We have questions. We're not getting many questions here. Our question machine is broken, right?
Oh yeah. Well,
what happened to our question machine? How to monetize open source? Open source is like saying, how do you monetize open knowledge? How do you monetize being able to read and write? Oh my God, I learned to read and write at school. It was free. How do you monetize a free school system? My God, come on, seriously, are you still asking this question? In 2015, you're still asking about the benefit of learning and the benefit of sharing knowledge in making money for us all, making life better. You cannot question this. Anyone questioning that is off on a tangent somewhere. Open source is the only way to make software that has any kind of real value. The only way. All closed source software is dead. It's not just dead. It's like religious education. It's like teaching kids the Bible as a form of cultural thing. Sorry? Yes, so is religion. Okay? Insanity and magic can be very profitable, but you know, we're on the science side of things. We know the difference between magic and science. Open source is science. Closed source is magic. So how to make money from it? I mean, you can make more money from closed source. Of course you can, if that's what you want to do. We don't do verbal questions. This is the IT generation. I just can't reach that far. Ask the woman in the red hat about making money from open source. Now we covered that. Just saying, cash. Well, literally, you can make money by becoming better at something and providing your services for profit. That's what I do. I get very good in certain things that are worth money to people, and I can charge pretty much what I like, and I can work pretty much when I want to and where I want to. I could not do that with the closed source economy. I could not do it as an employee. The only way to do what I do in my life is to have open source as my way of becoming better in things. I can be at the leading edge of very difficult problems, very valuable problems, solve them very well, and make good money from that. It seems a no-brainer. It does take a long time to get that good. I'm not saying I'm that good, but it took me a long time to get where I am. Like literally one day per day. Something about food. I'm actually too hungry to read that question out. I had no lunch. So the very mention of food, and my system starts going, wow, ich muss jetzt essen, jung. Yes. What if the code is crap? So, you know, it's like when you go to a restaurant and you buy a pizza. Like, we all like pizza, right? We can agree on that. Okay. Do you actually care how good the kitchen is? No, I mean really. Really, we don't care. Enough beer and pizza, we don't care what the kitchen is like. We don't want to know. What we care about is the pizza contract. I use this model a lot. The pizza contract is a very important contract. The pizza must have a certain size, right? We have a one portion, a two portion, a three portion, an American. Yes? The pizza must have a certain price. It must not cost too much or too little. A 1 euro pizza doesn't not good. It must be between 5 euros and 10 euros. It must have a certain temperature. It must not burn our mouth, nor must it be too cold. It must be the right temperature. And so on. And then there's subcontracts, like there's the margarita contract, there's the Four Seasons contract. These contracts are well defined. If you break them, you're an asshole. People won't come back, right? If you put anchovy on the Four Seasons contract, that's okay. On a margarita, that's not okay. Contract violation. And these contracts, they may seem like, you know, soft and gentle, but they're not. Pizza companies have gone bankrupt for putting anchovies in the wrong pizza. It's unforgivable. So we have these layers of contracts. And we enforce them by the very, very simple technique of not going back. Sorry, Domino's, I got sick last time, I'm not going back. But I will have a kind of a gentle retry after about 6 months. I'm hungry for Domino's and they have like a special Friday deal, I'll go back again one more time. You know, maybe I got sick from something else, you never know. So what I do not ask, what I don't care about is their kitchen. I don't want to know what's going on in their kitchen. I don't want to know their supply chain because I know it's horrid. We've all been there. We're all programmers. Well, most of us here are the ones who are not doing marketing. And we know how ugly code is when we get down to it. And beautiful code is rare, and beautiful kitchens are rare. And it's in the end, it's protein, right? Or not, or whatever. We check it on our reaction in the contract. So the same with software. Is it implementing the contracts that you care about? Can you measure those contracts, those implementations? Can you measure the quality you're getting, your cost? Can you recover from failure? Will the pizza kill you if it's bad? If not, then bad pizza is just experimental data. It's science. If this is nice. So again, you're focusing on the code, which is the wrong focus. What's really important are the people, right? When I'm building open source, I'm not really writing code. I'm building community. What happens when someone submits the bad pull request over and over again? What happens? Of course, I merge it every time. I merge. What happens next? This is on master, by the way. I merge onto master. I don't have this rubbish branch. Who wants branches? Seriously. I mean, come on. That's SVN. SVN had branches. No. We don't do branches. We merge on master. Now, what happens if Mr. X is a dick and he merges broken rubbish on master? What happens?
It breaks
master. Everyone's like, well, you broke master. And everyone's like, yeah. Peter, why did you merge it? I'm like, well, you know why I merged it. 2 minutes later, another patch comes. I merge that one as well. It's all reverted. So, of course, if it's easy to make a mistake, it's easy to fix the mistake, right? I don't do long reviews. I don't need to. And over time, master in our projects have always become very, very skeptical. Lots of test cases, lots of testing, continuous testing, because we don't trust anybody. There's no concept of trust. We trust nobody, obviously, because I will merge all the time. So you better well make a test case. Otherwise, your stuff will get broken in 2 days' time. There we are. And so it turns out that by bringing people in like that and giving them
what?
Time to deploy. No, we don't do that, of course. No one actually makes a release from master. That would just be stupid. You see, master is an unknown quantity. Master is like the front page of Wikipedia. Anyone can go and hack it any point in time. The hack is taken away, but the ability to go and modify it remains. And that ability is very, very important. Slowing it down, putting in any kind of barrier, slows down all of the positive cycle. And you lose, you may slow down the negative cycle, which is a very small cycle, but you slow down a very big positive cycle. So the trick is that you want to have somebody with a problem and a solution, and they make a solution, and they have no meetings, and no stand-ups, and no vision documents, and no sign-off, and no copyright transfer, and nothing to do except go to GitHub, make a pull request, and I merge it, and it's on master. And 90% of patches work like that and are correct and are good and are valuable. Sir?
Why do you give people access to pull requests? Why don't you give them this?
Commit. Yes. Due to Git and the way it works, having pull requests is more visible and it forces more discussion. It also forces this ping-pong effect between two people, so you can never merge your own pull requests. That's considered kind of vulgar. You can do it if you like on the project by yourself. It's considered also kind of vulgar. that's like, you know, in a corner somewhere. So you always merge someone else's pull request, and you put out there and you wait for it. And if you've ever tried that, it's very fun. You put something out there and someone says, yay. And it's like, whoa, it doesn't matter who it is. My daughter is maintainer on some of my projects. She's 11 years old. She will merge pull requests. And this sounds stupid, but when she merges my pull request, I'm like, yay. And seriously, part of my brain, even though I'm 53 and skeptical and I know what's going on, I set this whole damn thing up myself, still triggers on the fact that someone else is doing that cycle, completing it. It's a wonderful thing. So that's why we don't commit to master. It destroys that concept of being in a group, which is very important for the feeling of being in a project like that. Okay. Also, the pull requests are a very good container for discussions and why did you do this and blah, 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 blah. Who cares? It's all just rubbish. Don't discuss. Write code. Make changes. We're still discussing money.
Yes.
Okay.
That's a good question.
How to make money from ZeroMQ, from good open source. You cannot make money from bad open source. You can make money from good open source by making better products. If you make products that use ZeroMQ and that leverage, I like that word, that you reuse all that knowledge from all those people who had invested in ZeroMQ. ZeroMQ started as a toy for the financial industry, for speculators who are making trading systems, who are betting on the currency markets, all this kind of slightly suspicious stuff. But these people are making money from this every single day. So from the beginning, the very first version was used for profit. Now, if you can't leverage that in your, in simpler products, that's a little bit sad. So using it in products, making distributed systems with ZeroMQ can be very, very profitable if you can make good systems. It's still hard to use, I'm afraid. Making money is still difficult. There are many successful projects which have used ZeroMQ as their basic framework to start off, like Apache Storm. Who's heard of Apache Storm? Yes, it's ZeroMQ at the lower level. I think it was sold to Twitter for $20 million. And it wasn't a particularly complicated product. So once you can kind of understand how to build these kind of systems, which is not easy to do, then you can build systems which are very, very interesting and very profitable and very, very valuable. You can sell them if you want to. And some of my clients do that, and I help them do it. That's how I make money. Support licenses. Banks don't like to have unsupported software. They pay for support licenses. But that's me. That's not you guys. So open source basically opens doors, opportunities, which could not be opened otherwise. It allows small teams and individuals to compete globally. There's no way I could compete except being part of a large company. And as I explained, large companies are toxic for making large-scale systems, distributed systems. So I've got to be able to work as independent or as a small actor with networks of people, and I can only do that with open source. Basically, if you're a young computer scientist looking at software, well, read my books. The two of them, they're very good. They will teach you a lot about how software works as a social construct as well as technical construct. And then program and make software and be part of communities and just keep doing this for years and years and years. It takes about 5 or 10 years to become even good at that. It's like playing music. You can't become a good musician after 2 years. Right? What was the question? I missed it. The joke is gone from my head.
Selling books also makes money.
Selling books makes no money at all. Like, I would have brought books here, but I gave up because it was just carrying heavy bits of paper around. And I have, these books are fantastic. They're good marketing. And they're also very good because once you've written a few thousand pages, and writing is like, it's like writing code. It's not just you write the page and it's published. No. Every bloody sentence is being reviewed and edited like 16 times, and it goes over and over and over. So these books are like system code. It's very difficult to write a page of text, let alone thousands. And by the time you've done that, you know your stuff really well. Or you don't. I do anyway, so I can talk about this stuff for years, like not stopping like a Romanian dictator. So back to distributed systems. This morning I talked about cities and the food distribution system in cities, and they are a very good example of large-scale, decentralized, very critical systems owned by nobody or operated by the market, which we depend on every day. Everybody here had breakfast and lunch, and yet nobody owns the system that makes the food that comes here. It's run by tens of thousands, by millions of small operators and large operators, all fighting all the time to own this. No one actually ends up owning it. No one dies, usually from eating food. None of us go hungry. It's pretty amazing. That's what our software should try to emulate over time. That kind of level of reliability, of decentralization, of loose coupled agreement to make essentially, you know, essential stuff. It's a very opposite vision from we've made this. Here is the, you know, the new Apple meal. The Apple meal. We take you from breakfast to lunch to dinner. We control your intestine. It's like, no, I don't want that. I don't want to be, you know, owned by a corporation on that level. It can't even work. It will kill us, of course. That level. This 30 euro Amazon is not entirely true. If you self-publish your own books, you get about 60-70% of what Amazon sells it for, which is pretty good. If you go through, like one of my books is on O'Reilly, I will get about, I think about three euros per copy, which sells on Amazon for about 40. So yeah, something like that. So if you're going to do it, self-publish. It's more fun. If you do it for the money, no. The thing is, once you start thinking about money, your brain switches into a mode of basically cheating and lying. It's a very difficult, this has been tested by psychologists. If you prime people, like if I ask you to count these notes, and then you count these notes, it's called priming. And then I ask you to take part in an experiment where you have a chance of cheating or not cheating, you will be more likely to cheat. And more likely to cheat your colleagues and so on. And so putting people in the mode of thinking of money and counting money makes them dishonest. And that's something I like to avoid, so I'm not too worried about that. Forget about it. Apples all day, a lot of apples. Yes, it would be, wouldn't it?
You missed, there's an interesting question there that says, are there any systems that have been built commercially that couldn't have been built as open source? It's halfway the screen, huh?
Well, yes. I mean, I'm not against the use of money to make software. That's how I make my living, after all. I get paid to make software by people and help them to make software. The problem with open source is not a perfect way of doing things. And one of its weaknesses is that it takes time to arrive at a certain point. And you can force that by money. You can basically take money, you can push people to working faster in a certain direction. You can build systems that are impossible to make using open source. However, I will claim that forcing people to work and paying them to work creates dishonest software. By that I mean that it's like running fast in the wrong direction. And it's a very difficult thing to do in software is to solve the right problems. So anyone can solve problems, and you can pay people to solve problems. You can pay them to implement your vision, and most commercial software is like that, including the people I work for. It's vision. Based software, it's investor-based software, it's driven. And only a few products are not like that. Like we talked this morning about Gmail, Google stuff. Gmail is organically driven by small changes over time, works very well. Who uses Google Wave? Who uses Google Plus? Who remembers these things? These are vision-driven failures. Money does not make good software. Nobody could have made Wave using open source, right? Impossible to do. I call that, you know, dishonest software. It's very large, very ambitious, driven by vision, completely rubbish. Solving non-problems, just solving someone's need to express whatever childhood, I don't know, whatever disturbance they had. I don't know what it was. I mean, poor people, really. I must change the world. Oh, God. So what open source forces us into is, if we're lucky, and most open source still fails, right? This is not a magical formula. But open source forces us to work organically, and to work iteratively, and to compete with our solutions organically and iteratively over time, where the best will emerge. I think no one today that's serious about IT questions that, for example, Linux is the dominant operating system. I think you've got to be slightly... Okay, I mean, there are other things out there, but they're all second class, not even second class. They're like third class. They're like in the bottom of the water or the bottom of the ship. They're terrible, terrible things. Have always been. Closed source doesn't work very well, in my opinion, for that reason. Money does not make right. Money cannot, you know, change reality. And reality of knowledge is that we don't know what we're doing until we get there. We can't solve problems until we have a thing that's very close to the problem that we can measure, and that's the software that we're making. So without this kind of constant iterative process, it's very hard to make large-scale successful systems. And in my experience, all the big systems I've built, which were built by vision and money, have all died rather quickly. The few that survived were like built by people who knew what they were doing because they built it like 17 times before. Yeah, I like that. I thought about that a long time ago. It was absolutely essential. Totally in favor. And again, because the giving people a certain comfort, first of all, it's what we do anyway in a civilized society. We just call it something else. And secondly, it removes the incentive to be cheaters and liars. I think forcing us to think about money every day is a very corrupting. It's not that money is evil. Money is just a thing. But the human brain, when it's looking at counting beads or counting fishes or counting fruits, starts cheating. That's what monkeys do. So having a number of fish every day, we can afford it. We know we do it anyway in a decent society. It's good for everybody. It should just be simpler. Yeah. These are good questions, by the way. Plus one, all that. Okay, cool. Has anyone here read any of my books? One. What's wrong with you people? How about my blogs? Anyone? Documentation. Well, that's one of my books. On ZeroMQ. Or was it something else? Other documentation.
I don't remember. I just read a lot of documentation. I must have read something of yours in there.
Okay. I just printed it out on paper and sold it to people who are too stupid. Actually, it sells really well. I don't know why. I mean, the paper documentation, right? Yeah. Well, I think we're finished for today. I'm not going to hold you here any longer because I'm very hungry and I want to get some food. That's it. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Big hand for it.